Craig Brown from the Nova Scotia Community College. First, I'd start by thanking Richard for giving me the opportunity to present here today and to Derby University for hosting this conference. This will be a little bit different. I'm going to talk about some of the work that we're doing in Nova Scotia, in Canada, on, I guess, especially with ocean technology and ocean floor mapping. So I've never really considered myself a big data specialist, but I guess for the last decade and a half or more, I've been dealing with very large data sets to address oceanographic and applied problems. So my background is in biology and marine ecology and oceanography. So I have an undergraduate degree in zoology and a PhD in marine ecology. And then in the late 1990s, got involved in ocean floor mapping. So this is really addressing problems associated with how we use the ocean. So our fisheries, our aggregate mining, our oil and gas exploration, anything to do with providing knowledge and information to help solve problems. And over the last 20 years, we've seen an enormous data explosion in terms of how we can gather this information. So that's what I want to talk about today. So I'm going to try and provide that context, explain about the basic oceanographic problems that we're facing and some of the technology that has enabled us to do some really cool things now. And as these tools, analytical tools, get better, and as we've really grown in our capacity to handle larger and larger data sets and start to look at those relationships between oceanographic conditions, seafloor geology, and the patterns that we can see in the biological distributions, we're getting better knowledge to help manage and facilitate these systems. So I'm going to start off, just give you an introduction about the institute that I work for, the Nova Scotia Community College. And some of the applied research that we're doing there. My field's in integrated ocean mapping technologies, so I'm going to give a little bit of context about that particular field. So I appreciate that there's probably no oceanographers in the audience, so I'll try and start slow and provide that context. And there really has been a big data explosion, and I want to provide that, maybe some historical perspectives. I started in the late 1990s with analog data. We were collecting side-scan sonar data on paper. We could barely get this into a geographic information system to do the analysis. It was pretty basic univariate and multivariate statistics, looking for patterns and trying to link interdisciplinary data sets together. Now that's changed a huge amount over the last 20 years. We're now collecting digital data, we're collecting hundreds of terabytes of information, and we're trying to stitch this together in a multidisciplinary environment to look for patterns and provide information to stakeholders in the marine realm, whether that's industry players trying to maximize their catch of scallop on the seafloor, to the regulators that are trying to manage and safeguard those resources. So we work across both private sector industry and government partners to address these problems. So, I'm going to provide some examples of how we're using this data. So from a data analysis point of view, and we work a lot with the fishing industry and with the Department of Fisheries and Oceans in Canada, which are the regulators for a lot of the fish stocks. So you know, how do we stitch all this information together? The work that I do is very multidisciplinary. I'm a biologist by training, but I now have to understand geophysics, underwater acoustics, geographic information systems, seafloor geology, oceanography, currents. There's an extremely complex environment that we're trying to understand and use these tools to tease out information, ultimately to help sustainable management of the oceans. So I'm going to show you how we can basically generate lots of different map products to assist us in managing these systems. So you collect once, use many times. It's extremely expensive data to collect. When we go offshore on ships, we can be paying $40,000 a day just to get the ship out there. So, you know, it adds up very, very quickly. So we've got to really make sure we maximize what we can get out of that information. And then we generate lots of seafloor maps, different types of seafloor maps that we can use to help facilitate that. So I'm going to show you some examples that we're doing with the fishing industry. Then I want to finish off, you know, ongoing research activities at NSCC. Where are we going with our applied research? How that builds into our curriculum. So some of the soft skills that we talked about earlier. How do we link our applied research activities with our programs? And we have a, what we call the RAF model, that I'll talk a little bit about, research as a form of teaching. So here we engage our students in some of this problem solving direct with industry and get them really stimulated about what they're doing. So just to show you where we are, Nova Scotia on the east coast of Canada, a little province way out east, almost the most east loop. We've got Newfoundland just a little bit further east than us. And I'm based in Halifax, so the province is probably about two-thirds the size of England, but we only have a population of less than a million people. So it's a pretty rural province. Halifax is a city of about 300,000 people, beautiful place if you ever get the chance to visit. And we have a strong history in ocean tech and ocean research. There's a large federal research lab there, the Bedford Institute of Oceanography. It's just turned 50 years old just a couple of years ago, and a lot of innovative research has come out of the Bedford Institute. We have a number of universities in the city, Dalhousie University being one, that has a very big and successful oceanography department. And the Nova Scotia Community College, we pretend to be an over technical college, also working in ocean technology. And the city boasts the highest concentration of ocean tech companies anywhere in the world, and the highest number of PhDs working in oceanography anywhere in the world. So a very deep history in ocean research. So the Nova Scotia Community College, we're a technical college. Our mission is to build Nova Scotia's economy and quality of life through education and innovation. So we're very much the training branch of the provincial government. So we look at all the industry sectors in the province and we try and supply the workforce for those sectors. We're the second largest post-secondary institution in Nova Scotia, after Dalhousie University. 13 campuses right across the province, so we're very much, you know, we're very proud of that term community in our name. We try and support all these very rural communities, a lot of them based around fishing, traditional fishing communities, right across the province of Nova Scotia. So almost 24,000 students annually. We provide very applied hands-on training. Faculty all come with industry experience, and we also work directly with the industry for customizable training solutions. So we try and tailor our programs direct to industry needs, so our students go out there right for the workforce, of course. And we're very proud of our employment rates after our graduates go out there. They're extremely high, and a lot of our graduates go straight into the workforce. Applied research. College, research is normally associated with universities, but it's really started to grow in the college sector, and a lot of our research is applied. So we're down that spectrum towards industry. So all of our projects that we have going tend to work collaboratively with industry or government partners. So it's very much problem solving. And it's grown hugely over the last few years. The research councils now have specific funding programs for the colleges. So since 2000, we've really developed a multi-million dollar research operation at the college, focused on sort of providing innovative and problem-solving technologies, which have real practical, real-world commercial applications. And the college has been quite strategic about where we focus our research. We've got four areas. Geomatics has been our more traditional area of research at the college. It's the most established area. There's a lot of expertise at the Centre of Geographical Sciences, which is one of our rural campuses in the field of geomatics. So anything to do with surveying, satellite remote sensing, mostly traditionally terrestrial-based geomatics. But over the last few years, we now have very active and successful research activities going on in energy, so renewable energy, smart technologies, advanced manufacturing. We have state-of-the-art facilities at the college around engineering. We're now doing things like 3D printing in metal, which is really innovative and changing the way that we can address some of these challenges. And then more recently, I joined the college just 3 years ago in ocean technology, identified as a key area. So So we've grown extremely fast and we've been very successful. So since 2012, we now have research projects valued at about $16 million. $7 million around oceans type research. And my group, the Applied Oceans Research Group, we have about $4 million worth of research going on. So you're very successful. We've grown very, very quickly. So these are the guys that lead those different areas. These are my colleagues. And we all have big data analytics needs. Jim Webster, who leads the geomatics, they're collecting a lot of satellite remote sensing and LIDAR mapping data for the coastal zone. Again, these are multiple terabyte data sets, doing the same sort of stuff that I'm doing a little further offshore. And Al Joseph, again, energy research. They're now collecting data from all sorts of different sources, trying to understand how we can manage energy use, energy conservation. So you know, smart grid technologies, so an awful lot of research in that area. So across all these different areas, we have big data analytical focuses and needs. So this is the kind of thing we do. As I said, the geomatics guys, they tend to work on the dry side into the shallow coastal, using airborne sensors like satellites and aeroplane sensors like LIDAR, laser mapping techniques. I tend to deal with stuff further offshore. And again, my background's been in ocean floor mapping for the last almost 20 years now, and the technology's moved on hugely. That's what I'm going to talk about. So things like underwater acoustics, different types of sensors we can put down on the seafloor to measure and characterize the seabed. And we're now getting into the realm of things like autonomous underwater vehicles. So basically robotic submarines we can send out there, collect the data for you. So the technology has moved on hugely over the last 20 years. And our research in ocean technology has been really facilitated recently. In 2015, I was awarded an NSCC, which is the equivalent of NERC, Industrial Research Chair. Integrated Ocean Mapping Technologies. So this is effectively a $3.5 million project working with industry partners and addressing three broad themes. And I'm going to talk you through this. This is really how we're doing the research. So the first one is in the acoustic remote sensing technologies. So these are really what are enabling us to map the seafloor much better. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the technologies. The second one, what we call in situ ground truthing. So to actually validate what's down there, we can map the bottom with our echo sounders. But we need to validate what the characteristics are, whether that's the seafloor geology or whether it's the biology. So we have to put down either samplers or we tend to use a lot of underwater imaging systems, so underwater photography and video. So we drop those down from the vessels and we collect the information, which form our data sets, which we can then link to our acoustic remote sensing. And then the third point is how we link these together. Generate the maps. So this is kind of what I'm going to talk about. We're working with industry partners. Clearwater Seafoods are a large local fishing company that have grown up to a multi-million dollar business. They fish lobster, clam, scallop, and lobster, clam, scallop, and shrimp. So we're working very closely with them. They're doing some great data and analytics type work. They're very, very efficient in terms of how they collect and manage their operations and have become quite successful as a result. QPS are a software provider which generates software, produce software that we do a lot of the analysis of our multi-beam acoustics data, and we're working with a couple of engineering companies to develop new underwater camera systems. So the context. So this is little 101 in terms of oceanography and ocean floor mapping. What, why, and how? So we've been mapping the oceans for a long time for all sorts of different reasons. Traditionally, it might have been for safety navigation, mapping the coastline, mapping the oceans. So this is one of the early maps from the 16th century where they were more bothered about finding the coastlines. We didn't really know what was off there, so you see all the mythical sea monsters. Maybe this was the first seafloor habitat map. So we've come a long way since then, and the technology has enabled us to on. But essentially we need maps because it gives us information. We can use that information for all sorts of different reasons, whether it's safety and navigation or whether it's managing a resource. So maps are very powerful tools for management and understanding systems. Surprisingly, many people think, you know, maps of the ocean floor, we've got it all mapped. We know what's out there. We've got better maps of the surface of the moon and the surface of Mars than we do of the vast majority of the ocean floor. Only about 5% of the oceans have been mapped in the sort of detail that we now have on land. 2014 was the first time we got full, what we can say, you know, a comprehensive map using a single data set for the world's oceans. You know, and the world's oceans are 70% of the globe. It's a huge area of our own planet that we understand very little about. So this image looks fantastic. You know, a big ocean basin maps. You can see the red line running up the middle here is the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. So this is all the plate tectonics. You can see all the rifts and the faulting in the seafloor geology. You know, a beautiful data set. You've all been on Google Earth. You've seen the maps of land. You know, they're all plated with satellite imagery using light. So reflected light, you can now map down to about a meter resolution. Unfortunately, seawater light doesn't penetrate very well. So we're really limited to maybe 10, 20 meters to see the ocean floor using light. So the vast majority of the ocean floor, we can't map with the same techniques. This particular map's been mapped using radarsat, so radar technology, measuring sea surface elevation. So if you measure the sea surface enough and take away an average out of the tides and waves, what we find is that we get bulges or depressions around big seafloor features. So where you've got a seamount, we've got a little bulge of water caused by the gravitational forces, and you can infer seafloor topography. And this is exactly how this map has been generated. So it's great at this ocean basin scale. Let's think about trying to manage a resource at a finer scale, and just put that into context. Here's my hometown, Halifax. This is a Google Earth image, about a meter resolution. So you can see there's our scale bar, 2 kilometers. So the Nova Scotia Community College is here, where I work in Dartmouth. The peninsula of downtown Halifax is about 8 kilometers from end to end. We can use this remotely sensed image to make a thematic map. So something like a street map. You can see if I scroll back and forth, how easy there it is to map something like the citadel right in the middle of the city, you can basically just digitize. So our underlying data is allowing us to do these types of thematic map production. Now let's imagine that we're now offshore and we've only got data like I just showed you of the global map from Radarsat, which is at a 5 kilometer pixel dimension. So let's start to dumb this data set down. There's a 5 meter grid. There's a 1 kilometer grid. There's a 5 kilometer grid. So again, fit for purpose, the underlying data, we know very little about the ocean floor environment at that finer scale. And it's the fine scale that we have to need for managing things like fisheries or for marine conservation or for oil and gas exploration. So this is how we typically do it. And I'm going to talk about the technology. We now have things like underwater echosounders, multi-beam sonars, which I'll talk about, that allow us to collect detailed bathymetry at meter and submeter resolution. And we can derive other things that help understand the seabed environment from that basic acoustic information. So we can generate things like seabed slope, roughness. We can derive all these things from our acoustic remote sensing data. So we can stack those up. But we need to validate what's down there. We need to validate what the reflected sound from the seabed is telling us. What is the geology? Where are the biological species? So we do that by dropping down sensors. We can't do this everywhere, the oceans are huge. So what we tend to do is collect detailed information from sampling stations. This could be seafloor photographs, for example. And then we've got to integrate that and extrapolate to generate a map, whether that's a map of the seafloor geology, or whether it's a map that shows us where all the scallops are. So there's our remote sensing data. We're now getting down to sort of meter resolution with these new techniques. There's our in-situ sampling data, so our ground validation. So that provides the detailed information about the geology or the biology. This is where the analytics come in. So we've got to start combining these data sets, looking what the predictors are for the biology. Why do we find scallops in some areas and not in others? How do we extrapolate this detailed information spatially across our acoustic or sensing data to generate what we call a thematic map. So that could be a map showing something that is useful for an end user, so a manager or a fishing company. So that could be a map of the geology, could be a map of the biodiversity, could be a map of where the scallops are. Lots and lots of different ways we can slice and dice the data sets to provide a map product. So let's just go through the acoustic remote sensing, show you how the technology has moved on. So this is how we used to collect the data. Lead line. So this goes right back to Egyptian times. Hundreds of years of collecting seafloor bathymetry. You basically had a line with weight on, drop it off the side of the boat, you get a water depth. And believe it or not, quite a lot of our nautical charts, even from around the UK, still reflecting or still have data combined from lead line information. So this is Halifax Harbour. It was surveyed by Captain Cook using that very technique. So, from the 1940s, around the time of the Second World War, underwater acoustics, so echo sounders, the kind you find on most vessels, were invented. So you can send a pulse of sound from your vessel to the seafloor, you can measure the time travel, that'll give you bathymetry. So that really helped revolutionize the way that you can map the bottom. It really gives you a point measurement for each pulse of sound. And you know, you've got to run very tightly spaced grids so you get a detailed map of the seafloor. So there's some limitations, you know, revolutionary in terms of what it did. It wasn't until the late 1970s that we developed new technologies. These are what we call multi-beam echo sounders. So the early systems, the first one was in 1979, had angular coverage, so it looks like a swath. Angular coverage of about 45 degrees, 16 beams. It's like having 16 echo sounders pointing out in a fan shape. The new ones now, we have 150 degrees and over 500 beams. So the sophistication of the technology has come on hugely over the last decade. And we can get different amounts of information from these systems. So by measuring the time travel of each beam, we get the depth, called bathymetry. By running our surveys side by side, you see here we've got an area, this is several kilometers across, you see where the vessel's cutting the grass back and forth. You can take out the heave, pitch and roll for the vessel, take out the tides, stitch it all together. We've got a bathymetry map. We can measure the intensity of the sound coming back in each of those beams, something we call seafloor reflectivity or backscatter. People used to throw this away. It's a cycloid. We're interested in the bathymetry. Now we collect it, and we process it, and we've got better at processing it. And essentially that tells you how hard or soft the seafloor is. If you have a strong echo, the bottom is probably hard. A soft echo is probably soft. A lot of the sound is being absorbed by the mud. You get a weaker signal coming back. And we can present that as, say, a grayscale image. So here we've got hard, rocky outcropping reef, and here we've got mud. We can infer that, we don't know until we put something down to sample it. But essentially it's more information that we can gather. And then more recently, what we can also do is we can measure reflectors in the water column. So if you have fish, or bubbles, or plankton, it affects the intensity. So now we can record actual returns in the water column from these systems that we never used to be able to do. We still don't know how to process this data or what we do with it yet, we're still exploring. But what it really means is we've had this big data explosion. You know, we've gone from single beam echo sounders to multi-beam with 500 beams to recording backscatter, now to recording scatterers in the water column. So just to give you an example of the data volumes, 2 square kilometers of mapping data in about 60 meters of water gives about half a gigabyte of data. If we record water column, usually cuts it up by about 6 times. These are very from a rule of thumb. So we're talking about 3 gigabytes or more. So the data volumes have got bigger and bigger. It's all digital now. We can hold it all in. As the computers have got better to process this, we can now do more stuff with it. And the results can be pretty spectacular. This is about 3,000 square kilometers of data. This is off Cape Breton, off Nova Scotia. It's a marine protected area, so we're working with Fisheries and Oceans Canada to protect this site. This is the underlying multi-beam. Took several weeks of ship time to collect this data. It's all been stitched together. You're looking at the bathymetry, the topography of the seafloor. So it's color-coded by depth. The red areas are in about 10, 15 meters of water depth, and deep blues are down at about 150 meters. But even to those of you with no knowledge, you can see the features, you can see the geology. We've got lots of moraines here where the ice sheets, you know, deposited a lot of material in the last ice age. Some interesting geological features over here. In these deeper areas, we've got deposits of mud in here. As we go off into the Laurentian Channel, the bottom becomes much softer. We can overlay our reflectivity data on here and start to understand the geology. So from a mapping point of view, this is really powerful. Now, this is the first time we've seen the seafloor in this resolution. Really cool. We're now collecting more and more data sets like this. But we can start to map features. We can start to understand the geology, to start to understand the seafloor ecology. We can manage this site much better. So, you know, that's really where we're going, where we're at. It's really become more mainstream, and we're now getting the information that allows us to do some really cool stuff. So that was what we do up here, you know, with our bathymetry, our reflectivity data, and other derived information that we can get from that. We also have to validate. We can look at the reflectivity data, like you're seeing here, but what does this dark compared to light mean? We have to put down a sensor and figure out what it is. So that could be a physical grab sample, a physical sample of the seafloor that we bring up in the study. We can measure the grain size. More commonly now, we're using imagery. We're dropping down underwater camera systems and measuring and identifying what's on the bottom. So again, technological advances. Believe it or not, the first published underwater photograph was in 1893. This guy, Louis Bertin, French naturalist, took this picture of the Mediterranean. And again, you can see it's probably on what media he used. It's a pretty grainy image. Photography and underwater photography has been around for a long time. The first underwater video was in around 1940. It's all analog data. Typically, now we deploy cameras on frames. So we have a deployment frame fitted with the camera, lights, laser sizers, you know, pretty sophisticated bits of gear. We lower from the vessel to the seafloor where we want to validate what's there. And then we drift, collecting data, bring it back up. It's all georeferenced. We know exactly where those photographs are on the bottom so we can relate it to our acoustic data. And this is the kind of thing that we're looking for. Each of these photographs we can then interrogate. Here we've got gravel. As you tell them, these are actually feather stars. So you can actually zoom in, identify the biology. If we know the size of this photograph, we can collect quantitative data in relation to the biology. So we can identify all the species. We can do multivariate stats looking at the community structure. Again, looking at substrate, soft mud, cobbles. And lots of biology on there that we can go in and identify. As our camera systems have got better, we can extract more and more data from these images. We're actually building systems at the college. So part of the industrial research chair work that we're doing, we're building high resolution underwater camera systems. And again, the technology's exploded in the last few years. Anybody played around with GoPros? GoPros are now cheap, high resolution, $500 and £250 for a GoPro camera. These are now pressure housings. You can put a GoPro in, rated to about 1,000 meters. They cost $500. Well, traditionally, an underwater camera would have been about $15,000 to $20,000. So it's becoming much more accessible. Playing around with 4K, you know, super high resolution data. So when you think about data volumes here, going from standard definition to high definition out to 4K, just to give you an idea of the volumes of data we're gathering. You know, high definition for a minute, you expect 280 megs. 4K compressed, we're at about 700 megs. And we tend to record raw, so we can do more with it in terms of color correction and the like. 7 gigabytes a minute. And we'll be out collecting hours and hours of video. So, you know, huge data volume problems. You know, we're estimating probably somewhere between 50 to 100 terabytes of data we're collecting as these projects roll down the line. And then we have challenges extracting data from it. So, you know, that's usually done by eye. We're looking at all sorts of computer-aided methods to extract some information, but it's, you know, very challenging, especially when you want species identification and some of the challenges with image recognition. Again, lights as well, also revolutionary. LED technologies, we can now put down there, you know, thousands of lumens of light, which help us collect better quality information. So those are the kinds of data sets we're collecting. And we're now getting on to sort of the analytical part. So, you know, how do we combine it? How do we make sense of it? And there's lots and lots of different ways we can do this, lots of different methods and technologies. We tend to look at terrestrial remote sensing, what's being done on land, and borrow methodologies. They're probably a couple of decades ahead of marine. But a lot of the techniques, the statistical approaches are transferable. Even the software packages. So I'm going to show you some examples of different strategies. I'm not going to go into too much detail. I guess, you know, I don't want to get too into the weeds. Probably all glaze over when we start talking about some of this. But a few years ago, I published a review. A lot's happened in 20 years of seafloor, what we call habitat mapping. Benefit just means seafloor. Habitat mapping, trying to map the biological habitats on the seafloor for management. And, you know, we've defined habitat mapping as the use of spatially continuous environmental data sets to represent and predict biological patterns on the seafloor, continuous or discontinuous ways. The way we can present that data could be drawing boundaries around different regions and characteristics, or it could be gradational, saying what's the likelihood of finding species A within this area. This is where the analytics come in. This is really looking at patterns, pattern recognition, but from a biological point of view, trying to relate biological patterns with seafloor features, seafloor reflectivity data, seafloor slope, seafloor roughness, all these metrics that we can derive. And looking at 20 years of methodologies, we could kind of distill it down into sort of three very broad strategies. Mapping studies from around the world. We looked at about 150 studies, and again, I'm not going to dig into these, there's just too much information in here, but I just want to give you the broad feeling of what these methods are. So strategy one is where we don't have any ground truthing data. So let's just look at the patterns in our broad physical, you know, either whether it's acoustic or whether it's very crude bathymetry from radar sat. Let's look at those patterns and see what we can derive. There's been a lot of studies around the world, so essentially you might look at things like the tides and currents, bathymetry, seabed slope, could interpolate things like percentage sand, and do some kind of spatial modeling to generate a map that shows broad patterns at a continental shelf or even a, you know, country-wide scale. So you're not really validating, you're not bringing any ground truth in here, you're just looking for patterns in your underlying geospatial data. And this has been done by a number of groups. So the Joint Nature Conservation Committee in the UK started this work. They mapped the whole EEZ for the UK using this approach. So they brought in what spatial information they had, they modeled it, these are big data sets, came out with predictions in terms of habitat classes, you know, working on a standardized classification scheme. This was rolled out through the EMUDNet project all of Europe. So again, these are broad scale, these are general patterns. If we go in and map this with a multi-beam system, we'd see all sorts of error. And it's pretty broad brush, but it gives a starting point. If you're a conservation agency, you want to identify where the hard bottom is to protect it, go look there. The other two strategies I'm going to talk about from my work, so this is where we're going to get into some of the case studies. So, a few years ago, I worked at the Bedford Institute of Oceanography in Nova Scotia. I worked with the Canadian Hydrographic Service collecting multi-beam data, and I was cross-appointed with the DFO Science Department, Fisheries and Oceans, working with the population ecology fisheries people. And they had a problem associated with managing the scallop fishery. Scallop is a unique species, you know, it's spatially aggregated, and it's linked quite closely to seafloor habitat. So we could use underlying multi-beam data to help or try and improve the way that this fishery is managed and extract more value from the data that we had available. So the case study area is down here. So this is Nova Scotia, Halifax is up here. This is what we call German Bank, one of our glacial banks just off the southwest of the province. You'll see that the nearshore fishery fish in these management blocks, A through to E. And we've got multi-beam data from about the early 2000s from this region. So good underlying data that we could extract more information. So we're going to talk about this over the next few slides. We really tried out what we call a top-down strategy, an unsupervised classification, and a bottom-up strategy, which was a supervised classification, to generate maps showing different things. So our top-down method, which I'm going to show you, basically looks for patterns in your multi-beam data. So you're basically segmenting. You're looking for patterns in your broad-scale geospatial data without bringing in the ground truthing. So you basically segment into categories, and then you bring in your ground truthing and validate and try and match them up. So that was the first thing we attempted. And again, don't worry about the details. There's just too much in here. We don't really have time to drill down. So essentially, this is what we're talking about. We have our multi-beam bathymetry. We have our reflectivity data. We can derive other things from it. Again, I'm not going to get into the details. But we can generate things like seabed slope from the bathymetry, which can be good predictors of biological patterns. Things like curvature and roughness, all sorts of secondary derived information from our bathymetry that can help understand the seafloor environment and generate maps. So we segment in a multidimensional environment. So we're basically looking for patterns across the layers we feed in. And then we validate what those classes are from our ground truth. And in this case, we went out in 2010 using a towed camera system. So this little platform here, it's like a little robot. It's basically towed behind the ship on a data cable. It has downward looking stows cameras and video cameras and lights. And we can collect georeference data. So we had about 3,000, just over 3,000 georeference photographs from across this area. The area is about 5,000 square kilometers, so it's a big site. So there's the site. Ignore E, we had challenges with the multi-beam data, and it's not really a very efficient area. So there's a lot of other challenges that come into this in terms of the multi-beam and the reflectivity data that pose headaches. So we use this as our multi-beam study area. So there's the bathymetry. The red areas are about 10 meters. Down here we're at about 200 meters. So again, range of depths. You can see the edge of a bank here. This is the German bank itself. So the morphology of the seabed varies across the site. It's quite complex. From the bathymetry, we can generate things like seabed slope. Again, this can be good predictors of what biology lives there. So again, just predicting, you know, plotting the slope. This is kind of roughness, curvature. Shows you how, whether the seafloor is convex, concave, sloping, flat. Again, good predictors of the biology. And then our backscatter. Again, I'm not going to go into the details. These are derivatives from the backscatter, trying to extract as much information as to how hard or soft the seafloor is. We call them Q1, Q2, and Q3. So we feed those into a geographic information system, and basically we're looking for patterns across those six data layers and segmenting using statistical methods. This is how we generate landscape maps on land with multispectral data from a satellite image. Red, green, blue, or whatever bands you want to put in there. You basically look for patterns in your underlying data, and then you go in and see how it matches with your ground truth. So our statistical technique was saying 15 acoustic classes. So it's saying we can identify 15 unique features from across those six bands. Each of these little squiggly lines is where we have camera toes. So that's where our photographs come from. Again, think about a photograph. Maybe looking at a square meter of seabed. This is 5,000 square kilometers. So you know, you're basically extrapolating that little peak you're getting from your camera system to the rest of the area. So 15 acoustic classes. From our 3,000 photographs, we can classify using basic decision trees into what we've identified as five bottom types. So what we're calling reef, glacial till, in three soft sediment classes. So we're pretty confident from where we have the ground truthing, every photograph can be classified into one of those five bottom types. calling the benthoscape. It's like landscape, but it's the benthic or seafloor environment. So then we're looking for those broad biophysical characteristics. So these are our five classes. And then what we do, we can map that back in a geographic information system and see how they line up with our 15 classes. Look for the best match. Start to merge our acoustic classes back together to match our five classes that we get from our imagery. It's objective. We come out with accuracy scores. So we're getting about 70% accuracy, which is actually quite high for this type of analysis. And where the problem lies is the spatial scale. So you know, we're getting little pockets of glacial till in amongst the reef. So when you get a photograph, it's really in a reef area. What we're seeing is still a misclassifying photograph. So spatial scale becomes a big challenge. But overall, you know, we're quite happy with that result. We can then map that back, collapse those acoustic classes back to match our five, and also our benthoscope. So you can see where the false classes then disappear based on our best match. We've got our benthoscope. So again, very useful in understanding. You know, we now know reefs and the tail are on the shallow bank, which we know. And down in the deeper area where all the soft sediments deposit, we're getting our soft sediment classes. So that's what we call an unsupervised classification. We can also slice and dice the data in a different way. So we're now going to look at a supervised way. So where we can take something like, where are the scallops? So we know where the scallops are. And we know we can identify the bathymetry, slope, reflectivity, any other parameters we throw in there, we can then model and predict spatially suitability for that species. That's essentially what we did. Again, same data sets, click once, use many times, the same stack of multi-beam layers, same photographic data set, this time rather than classifying it into habitats, the same presence or absence of scallop in the photograph. And then essentially what we're doing is suitability modeling. So based around ecological niche, we know the scallops have a preferred environment to live in, preferred bottom type, preferred depth, preferred seafloor slope, preferred seafloor roughness. And by extracting that information and then predicting, we can come up with a suitability map to show where you're likely to find scallop. This is our benthoscape map that I just showed you, showing the different bottom types. This is our suitability map for scallop. So it's a hot-cold type image. The red is where we're predicting is highly suitable habitat for scallop, right through to blue, which we're saying is unsuitable. And again, our models are telling us we're about 72% accurate in this case. The best way to validate this is to see where the scallop fishing industry are fishing. Fishermen know way better than we do where the scallops are. And we have an independent data set. All the scallop fleets within the near shore have been fitted with vessel monitoring systems. So we know exactly where they've been fishing over that time period, completely independent to how we make these maps. And we can overlay that. So it should, in theory, line up on the red area. That's what we found. So again, incredibly powerful. A lot of confidence in terms of the maps that we're generating. So these types of maps are of value to the fishing industry because they can go catch the quota more efficiently if they know where the scallop suitability maps are. It means that they don't tow the gear on an unsuitable bottom and cause damage to areas where they shouldn't be fishing or they don't need to fish. So there's a win-win situation from an environmental management point of view and from an economic point of view for the fishing industry. We can start to look and again interrogate the data a little more. So we're not doing this in any of the packages we've talked about today, any of the data analytics packages. You know, we're doing this extracting information using a variety of different software and statistical methods. But essentially, we can map things like scallop habitat suitability by benthoscape class. So we see that the scallops are found on the till, silt, mud, and reef, but not so much on the other soft sediments. We can look at the fishing intensity from our vessel monitoring data from the fishing fleet. Against bottom type, you can see that most of the fishing happens on till. And when they're fishing down here, they're on the wrong bottom, they're not going to catch scallop. The fishing industry don't have these maps yet, so you can see why we're getting those challenges. But then we can also look at intensity of fishing by suitability. So they are actually targeting those hotspots very, very well. You know, there's that link here by suitability. So this is a suitable bottom. They're not fishing where there aren't any fishing industry. They know where those resources are from trial and error, from experience. We can dig a little deeper. I'm running out of time here, but we can start to look at the patterns in terms of suitability. We can bin those into, say, high, medium, and low, rather than having a hot, cold color ramp. And we can start to analyze what's the suitability of bottom within each of these fishing areas. So my colleagues in the Department of Fisheries and Oceans will manage and set the quotas for scallop each year from stock assessment surveys. Start to look at the fishery from a spatial context. This information wasn't available before. So we can see in here the high suitability class from 0.6 up to 1 is in the blue, the unsuitable, the low is in black. And we can see that the high suitability comprises only 15% of area D. So again, most of the population is coming out of a small area of the seafloor within that area. So we can break down the fishing activity by year. And again, this is fishing intensity. Before we had the suitability maps, this is all that we can see. We break it down by suitability now and plot the vessel monitoring data on top of these three classes. We can see that they're hitting the high suitability ground much more than the medium, much more than the long. So it's providing much more spatial information to help model and manage the stocks and set the quotas for this fishery. Similarly, each year, Fisheries and Oceans go out and do an independent stock assessment survey. So they do tows across that area, and they count commercially catchable scallops and new recruits. So you can use the population statistical modeling to predict what the population size is and what is a safe amount to extract from the fishery each year without causing the population to crash. Before we had the maps, in area D, this is the recruit, so these are the small scallops that are not commercial size yet. This is the years, so each year they go out and do a survey, we can see what's happening over time. We've got a recruitment event here where we've got more scallops coming into the population. You can see that around 2004 or 5, we're getting a bit of a peak. When we start looking and stratifying the same stock assessment data against suitability classes, which we can now do, so we can historically look back at one of those stations that we fished with stock assessment data against suitability, this is what we see. So we see for the recruits, there's much more recruits in the high suitable bottom and medium to the low. Similarly here, this is the commercial size scallop. So again, they're traditionally much higher in the high suitability, to the medium to the low. But look what's going on here. Affects the fishing. So they're fishing down that population to the point where the population in the high suitability is now the same level as the medium. So we know that the fishing from that previous slide consistently across that time period, the fishing in the high suitability areas were higher, because that's where they know to get the biggest catches. But even when the stock decreases, they're continuing to fish there because that's where they know in the past they've got high stocks. So we now have that spatial information where we can understand the fishing patterns and the fishing pressures against the population sizes. And now what the Department of Fisheries and Oceans are doing is building this information into their stock assessment model. So now you can feed this into setting the quotas and manage the fishery from a spatial perspective. And it's providing very, very useful, powerful information. There's buy-in from the fishing industry, and there's big support for this from a regulatory side, because the fishing industry don't want to fish this stock to extinction or to a point where it's unsustainable. If you can manage the fishery and put in management strategies so that you can keep the high suitability ground higher, it's a win-win from an environmental and from a fishing industry point of view. So those are the kind of walk through our data analysis type tools and techniques. Hope you all stayed up to date with what we're doing there. And it's quite involved, there's a lot of different disciplines. I want to finish off the last 5 minutes just talking about some of the other things that we have on the go. From a traditional big data analytics type of perspective, NSCC has a couple of new programs that I think are coming online this year. I've not been directly involved in them, but we have a business intelligence analytics, an advanced diploma, so this is a graduate level diploma, and an IT data analytics diploma coming online. We're also looking at developing content around ocean technology, and we've got an ocean technology advanced diploma and a marine geomatics advanced diploma. So these don't specifically look at handling big data sets. The ocean tech is really focused on understanding the equipment that is used, troubleshooting, operating, maintaining the equipment. The marine geomatics is all around the collection of data, things like multi-beam data and geospatial data. But clearly, it's good for our students to be data literate, data aware, at least familiar with some of the big data concepts and how we can process and analyze some of this data. So we're looking at how we can incorporate content and develop those programs from a big data analytics point of view. We have what we call the RAFT model, research as a form of teaching. And this is really where the applied research department in the college tries to link in with the training programs that we offer. So every program, or not every, but certainly a large majority of programs will have things like senior year projects. So the students have a one-year project that they do to try and link them in with industry challenges, industry problems, and get them working on hands-on with an applied research problem to solve an industry question. And we found this as being very, very successful along the lines of earlier, get them engaged in the topic, get them picking the projects that they're interested in, get them working on a real-world problem, even with an industry partner. So again, it builds up those soft skills to learn to communicate, to working directly with the industry, and we're seeing a huge amount of success from that kind of engagement. We take that further, some of the programs will have internships and industry placements. So we're trying to get our students out there working directly with industry partners. Or we pull them into the larger applied research projects that those four research areas are working on. And again, those tend to be in partnership with industry, so they're still getting exposure to real world problems. So integration of industry-focused research within the curriculum is primary. And we're in a good position. Our faculty come from industry, so they have great industry connections. We are the provincial training arm, the training arm for the provincial government, so we have those strong links with industry. So we're really seeing this as a benefit to our graduates. From an applied oceans research point of view, this is the kind of thing that we're trying to do. As I said, most of our projects are with industry partners, so we're growing the number of partners we're now working with. This is the whole idea behind these industrial research chairs, to grow capacity within the research field. We're working with government, so we've got very strong links with the Department of Fisheries and Oceans. We're doing projects with them on conservation mapping, on fisheries resource mapping, with the Geological Survey as well, into the geological mapping. And we're partnering with other academic institutions. So we've got close links with Dalhousie Memorial University. I'm an adjunct prof at Memorial. We're supervising PhD and master's level work. Feeds in and links up with the work we're doing at college, which is more technical. And building those multidisciplinary teams really leads to where we're going on innovation. Thinking outside the box, working across disciplines, bringing that information together, coming out with innovative solutions. And we're really excited by the latest development. So this was a $20 million funding program that we were just recently awarded. This is the Dartmouth shoreline, so Halifax is over here. This is the Nova Scotia waterfront campus, NSCC waterfront campus where I work. And just down the waterfront is the old Coast Guard base, which has been bought by the Halifax Waterfront Development Corporation and is being turned into an ocean technology park. So this has been developed, this has been led by NSCC. Huge amount of interest from small to medium startup ocean tech companies. The idea here is that they can work side by side, direct water access. This is going to be called Cove, the Center of Ocean Venture and Entrepreneurship. So again, building that entrepreneurial spirit within our students, get them working on applied research projects and their programs. When they finish, go out there and start your own company. Commercialize what you're doing. Let's take that innovation further, get it right out there into the marketplace. So this is coming online, I'm really excited about this. We hope to plug the Applied Oceans Research team into this facility and work side by side with industry doing the kinds of things that I've just been talking about. I think I'll stop there, I'm just about on time. Again, I put myself down as the author at the start, but this is not solely me, this is a huge team effort. It spans multiple positions that I've held over recent years. So I know it's thanks to a huge team that I work with. And some really great people, geologists, oceanographers, geomatic specialists, acousticians. They're all in there. They all really make this possible. Thank you.
Any questions?
Resolution we can now do with the multi-beam technology.
It seems that what we're doing is very advanced. Is that not the case for other organisations around the world? Or is it?
So the technology has really enabled this to happen. A lot of it comes down to cost, getting out there and collecting the data. Canada was probably one of the leaders in the late 90s in terms of testing out and using the multi-beam technology. It's become mainstream. Systems have got cheaper, but we're still $400,000 to purchase, and then you've got the ship time on top. But we are now starting to see this become mainstream. Ireland was the first nation, I think, anywhere in the world to comprehensively map their economic exclusive zone. So they've been doing this for about 8 or 9 years now, I think. They spend tens of millions of euros doing it, and they've made that data open source. So the idea is people can download the data, they can go out and click their own ground truth and they can do stuff with it, add value to that baseline information. So we're now starting to see countries really think about the value that this information can provide across multiple industry sectors. And as the tools have come online, a lot of the analytical tools to add value to the underlying data, we're seeing some tremendous benefits from doing that. Norway is now moving ahead with this, the US, the UK is doing quite well collecting multi-beam data from offshore regions. Canada, where we've had a bit of a lull, but hopefully that will turn up and we'll start to collect systematic multi-beam data now and generate these products and add that value.
Did I read recently that various commercial fleets are beginning to be used to capture some of this data? How's that going?
There's certainly a lot of data now being collected and integrated. Some of it multi-beam, but some of it single-beam. There are systems out there now like Olex, which is a Norwegian company that basically says we've got single-beam echo sounders on pretty much all the vessels. If you buy an Olex license, we'll take all your data and start stitching it all together and we'll generate maps of all the regions. And those databases have grown and grown and grown over the years. The accuracy is not quite the same as this kind of stuff, but for certain applications it's fit for purpose. The fishing industry don't need to know within 1% accuracy where the seafloor depth is. As long as you get the broad patterns, you can identify where to fish and where not to fish. For other applications, safety and navigation, there's obviously legal implications. Generate a bathymetry chart and you miss something like that sticking up to within a few meters of the surface, that one's not. In some cases, the shoals will be quite close to the surface. If you miss that and you don't put it on your chart, then you're liable that you haven't done your due diligence. So, fit for purpose application comes into it. you're certainly seeing, you know, much more wide-scale use of these technologies out there. And it's become more accessible, more easy to use. Costs have started coming down. Things like inertial motion units, IMUs, which are really important for collecting the multibeam. Imagine the boat, ski pitching and rolling, you've got a swath, you're trying to measure accurately where the bottom is from a single GPS feed coming into the vessel. Inertial motion unit would cost anywhere from $50,000 to $120,000. You're now seeing drone technology come in with boards that you can buy for $70. So we're starting to see technology really coming to the fore. The price is starting to drop down with a lot of these systems. So we're going to see more wide-scale adoption, and then hopefully, you know, if the vessel's out there, we can start to collect this information routinely.
Thank you.